Hey guys, it's Nefi. Thank you for joining me once again. As you guys know, I am an urban apologist. I answer questions related to being Christian, being Black, and being woke. And today, I want to answer the question regarding why I left Kemet, or the Kemetic Conscious Community. So in this video, I will introduce you to what Kemet is, if you're not familiar, talk to you about how I got involved, what it was like being there, and then of course, ultimately, why I left. You'll want to stay tuned for this. So what is Kemetic Consciousness, or the Kemetic Conscious Community? It goes by a few different titles because there is no real title to it. It used to just be simply called Consciousness or Black Consciousness, but the adoration and admiration for Kemet or Ancient Egypt kind of became part and parcel of it. So consciousness simply means to be awake, right? To be aware. So conscious folk have been the originators of the term woke. Like, they were the first woke people. It's become mainstream and commercialized almost. And so the definition of what it means to be woke has become kind of obscured over time. But originally, it meant that you were aware of the different tools of oppression that society uses to keep Black people subjugated. That was the main focus. And then of course, understanding African identity and the supposed origins of our culture, right? So that's the focus of it. And people often call members of this community, which even calling it a community is a little like, it's a bit loose because it's not like you go somewhere and you sign up, and it's not like being a member of a church or something. They don't necessarily gather together. There's a lot of different types of people in terms of where they stand spiritually and what their spiritual beliefs are. So it really isn't a community in that sense. But there used to be some level of, you could say, community, because there were like gatherings at Black bookstores or coffee shops where they sold like clean foods, and they would talk about politics and race and issues that they felt like most people don't talk about. And so this is the whole concept of being woke or being awake. You're being awake to things that other people either don't know or don't care about, right? And they don't know because they don't care is kind of the premise. So one of the terms that people have also used to identify this group is the word Hotep, because that is like a greeting. It means peace, right? And so they often have been known to greet people by saying Hotep, and that kind of branded them the name Hotep. The music in that community, or the music when you're in that environment, typically seems to be, if you're a consistent Hotep, if you're a consistent member of the conscious community, which people these days don't like to be called Hoteps. I don't think it was ever intended to be derogatory, but even though they name themselves Hotep, whatever, they don't like to be referred to as that. So if you are a member of the conscious community and you're consistent, a lot of times the music, at least when I was involved, was characterized by people who were very enlightened in their own way, well-read, and it seemed uplifting, which is kind of like a response to racism, a response to oppression, a response to the both blatant and subconscious messages that have been sent to Africans in the diaspora about their supposed inferiority ever since slavery, right? So in response to that, you have rappers that I'm going to talk to you about, the ones that I personally listen to, Dead Prez. I'm an African, never was an African American, blacker than black, I take it back to my origin, same skin, hated by the Klansmen, big nose. Nas. Before we came to this country, we were kings and queens, never porch monkeys. There was empires in Africa called Kush, Timbuktu, where every race came to get books to learn from Black teachers who taught Greeks and Romans. Conscious Pop, not Ratchet Pop. They're Tupac's, apparently. You know, Tupac. That wasn't even on purpose.
It's time for us as a people to start making some changes. Let's change the way we eat. Let's change the way we live, and let's change the way we treat each other.
And then again, for me personally, I listened to conscious reggae, which was like Sizzla.
Look, woman and child, you, yeah. For you, I really have so much
you're encouraged to eat healthy, you're encouraged, whatever that means, whatever your definition of eating healthy is, you're encouraged to promote unity within, amongst African Americans, learn about the power of economics, learn about politics, and do what you can. You're encouraged to do what you can to uplift the African American community. And we'll talk a little bit more about that and my experience with that later on. Basically, like, I read this book, I was 16 years old, and I was given this book by two people who were conscious themselves, two older men who had been very well read as well. And the book was called From the Broderfile by Anthony Broder. And I could not put the book down. Like, I read all day, every day, for 3 days. I devoured that book at the age of 16. And the themes in the book were basically, like I said, like a correction, an assertion, a claim that the author was intending to correct a lot of the myths that are associated with being African or being of African descent, and also supply what he refers to as like hidden truths about the origins of a lot of things within our community. So having experienced racism myself, I grew up, half of my childhood was in a predominantly Eurocentric, I would say, Latin community. And even though my family is Latin, we're still Black, and there is racism in the Caribbean and in Latin communities because there was slavery there, you know, of course it's gonna follow, right? So, I think it resonated with me due to my experience with that. But just, you know, being a member of society and somebody who's always been hungry for knowledge and truth, I think also was some of the reasons why I gravitated so well towards that book. So in the book, there's a lot of assertions that are made that I wouldn't realize until much later were nothing more than just that. And I'm going to explain that to you in a moment. But, you know, I just want to say, like, I was brought up by a very Afrocentric mother. She was involved in the BSU in college. She, you know, had me rocking African garb and turbans when I was a kid. So, like, it wasn't foreign necessarily to me, the concept of Afrocentrism, but it wasn't something that I had personally adopted until that time, reading that book. So, what was like being in there? Like, at first, it's a shock to your system. At first, it's like you're shocked by these claims that of this greatness that your ancestors possessed that flies directly in the face of the narrative that has been taught and handed down over generations. So, you know, some people will disagree, but by and large, the media and whatever you include in that, that's textbooks, that's television, movies, radio, that's print, like magazine, just regular books, so-called historical documentaries, the narrative has pretty much been the inferiority of Africans and African descendants. And so I taught Black history, and I have a wealth of information regarding this. The fact that racism was prevalent far after slavery is pretty much historical fact, right? So what it does is it angers you initially because it's like, they're telling you things like, everything that you, just everything of significance that you can attribute to our society's advancement was really stolen from Africa and repackaged as European product. These kind of things kind of capture your attention, and if there's going to be a lure to a lie, there's going to be any pull to it, there has to be truth in it. And so I definitely think that there's some truth. I don't think it's a ton of truth. I don't think it's the majority of what's presented within Afrocentricity is true. I think it is a response to, once again, oppression and like an overcorrection, like an overcompensation, right, for the things that we've suffered. But the positive aspect is, like, I guess, what can be deemed positive, at least in my experience and my memory of having been a member of this subculture, is like, it's, first of all, I love to read. I'm a bibliophile. So reading was, and I say was because, like I said, it's become mainstream now to call yourself woke, but back then, the central place of gathering before social media was the bookstore. So you're kind of focused on reading. I would say that's very positive. That's very positive that they encourage people to read, that they encourage unity, at least verbally. A lot of these things are done verbally. As a member of this subculture, that's how I adopted the name. So my name is Nefer Nidhi. Nefer is an ancient Egyptian word that means beautiful. Nidhi is short for impunity, and I've had the name impunity since I was like 13. When I turned 16 and I became conscious, I added the Nefer to it. Impunity is a word which means exempt from harm or punishment, which I interpret to be free. So my name means beautiful freedom, right? So I locked my hair. I had locks for like 10 years. What else? I stopped perming my hair as a result of reading this book before I locked it, because it talked about Europeanized standards of beauty, right? And it wasn't just that book. There are a set of books that people will have in their library, like they're like staple books. And it's kind of like if you ever used to watch MTV Cribs, and every time they go into a rapper's house, they always had Scarface DVD in their DVD collection and like some form of alcohol in their fridge. If you didn't have those two things, it's like, why are you even on Cribs? Like it was like necessary to show Scarface in the DVD collection and alcohol in the fridge. And so there are a few books that are staples. You can't call yourself conscious if you haven't read the Isis Papers or They Came Before Columbus or From the Broader File, books by authors like Naeem Akbar, Yosef Ben Yohanan, you know, things like people like that. So it was a series of books, but a lot of them, of course, because they're part of the same subculture, they have the same message. And the message is essentially, you've been lied to, and not only have you been lied to, but the people who are lying to you stole the truth from you and repackaged it as their own, and then basically told you were worthless when all the greatness that you see originated from you. Like that's the essential core message, right? And so yeah, so I became a proponent. Like, you know, I was telling people about the supposed origins of different things, and I wrote a newspaper for the high school, like my own personal newspaper. It was called The Peace Papers, Proud, Eager, Aware, Concerned, Educated. And I would write articles about segregation and identity, and I would write about, you know, things like the origins of the N-word, which is something that he Browder covers in that book. So I jumped in headlong. Like, I was fully involved. I got a tattoo of an unk. I used to be offended too. Like, if I would see somebody with an unk and they weren't woke, it was like, what are you even do? Like, what are you doing? Why are you wearing this? Like, you are a culture vulture at this point. Like, so that's kind of how I became identified. Like, people around me recognized the change and affiliated me with African consciousness, because I was never quiet about it. Like, I wanted other people to wake up and see this greatness that we had, and like focus on things that were important, like politics and history, instead of the common entertainment, which is sent to dull our senses and give us messages that we will perpetuate, stereotypes that we will perpetuate subconsciously because they're being fed to us over time. And so, like I said, a lot of things that they taught and teach, you know, in their essence are true. I think they're missing a lot of components, like a major component, which we'll talk to in a moment, talk about in a moment. But essentially, part of the message in terms of racism and and distraction and oppression, a lot of those things ring true, right? So then if it's so true, and if it's such a positive environment, then why did I leave? I left essentially because I started chipping away at what I was being taught. First and foremost, the main reason I left was spiritual. So I had grown up apart from being in a Afrocentric household and being raised Catholic, there was syncretism, and so there was also the African traditional religion of Yoruba or Ifa. So I had seen a lot of spiritual things, and even though I eventually wound up leaving Christianity because of my journey in this subculture, I was never one who doubted the unseen, because I had seen and experienced far too much for that to ever happen. Like, you could not convince me that spirits don't exist. My quest was to find the truth and who the true living God was. But you know, we were sold this lie in that book that I haven't touched yet, but about Christianity not being a true faith, right? And so another thing that people associate with consciousness is the abandonment of Christianity. They kind of go hand in hand at this point. So why I left. So again, I left Christianity because in this book and all of them, the common theme amongst them, it's almost like you can't leave out the issue of religion, right? So they're not just going to talk to you about culture and history and politics and media, but they're also going to talk to you about religion and the supposed origins of Christianity. And being someone who was new to this information and didn't really have a system or process in place to refute it, I was distraught for a while, and just like gave up on Jesus, because you know, these books tell you that Christianity was an invention of Europeans and that the original faith is indigenous to Egypt. And I believed it. Like, I legit believed it. I legit started following these ancient African deities. You know, I had like the 42 principles of Maat in a shrine with like an incense burner with basically idols of Maat present. And I engaged in Kemetic conscious, I don't know, spirituality, right? For a while, because it's old, it's black, I'm black, I want the original stuff back, you know what I'm saying? Like, all that. So that's kind of where I was at. But I also was still on a quest to find who God was and speak to God and ask him questions. And I remember very distinctly asking questions while I was studying in my room alone, or while I was out in nature alone, and just sometimes I would speak them, but a lot of times they were just in my mind. And then like the next day or following a couple days, somebody would come up to me and just answer the question. Like, they answered it. You know how like in school they teach you to write a complete answer, like an answer in a complete sentence, and your sentence has to restate the question. So if the question is, why did Billy get to school late? The answer says, Billy got to school late because, right? So people used to come to me and just, Billy got to school late because this and this and this. And it's like, I didn't even ask you about, how did you, like, of course, I didn't really express that to them, but I already knew that I was having communication with the Most High, right? So then also I had a group of people who invited me to church, and I wasn't, I mean, this story that I'm telling you, this history that I'm telling you about myself spans a few years, right? So it started off when I was in high school, but I'm well into college and I'm still like, you know what I mean? So, but I was invited to church, and as kind of like a courtesy, I went ahead and went along, and a lot of the things that were stated during the service resonated with me, and it became now a war, right? It became a war within me as to what the true faith was. But my mind kind of, you know, mentally, I already had this conflicting information with regards to Christianity and why it was false. But I want to say, like, spiritually, I felt pulled to Christianity. Now, I also will say, I felt pulled in a thousand different directions. Like, I felt at one point or another, like, I felt pulled in a bunch of different directions. But this was one of them. And during this time, I think it was pivotal, because I was able to start studying and learning what it means to study. So you heard me correct myself a couple times, saying that people weren't necessarily well studied, they were well read. And the difference is, it's kind of like even just reading the Bible. Like, you can't just pick up the Bible and read it. I hear people all the time, I've read the Bible from cover to cover 5 times. Like, that's great, but like, that doesn't mean anything. Like, there are people who've dedicated their entire lives to just studying the Bible, right? And, you know, and there's still more that could be understood from what's written in it. So just reading these books by these different authors will expose you to a lot of information, which you can later find out is misinformation. And the irony of that is, but anyway, it can expose you to information or misinformation, but studying will help you find out the root of the truth and whether the truth is being presented to you or not. And so so studying what Broder said in From the Broder File, I'll give you an example. On page 69, he talks about Helios Biblios, and he says that this is where the word Holy Bible comes from. And Helios means sun, and Biblios comes from papyrus, which means book. And these are Greek words, and they're hiding from you the fact that the Bible is a sun book full of astrology, because they changed the word from Helios to holy. And that's a lie. Like, it's something so basic. It's so easy to discover the truth behind that if you move beyond what's being presented to you and just fact check. But most people don't do that. And I think a lot of us, myself included, in those times, I didn't know the difference. I wasn't aware of the difference between reading and studying. I thought they were the same thing. So, but now I understand, and I teach this in my online class, how to conduct research. And when you read a book, reading a book is pretty much indistinguishable from having a conversation with somebody, unless there are primary sources cited to in the book, right? And what I mean by that is, a lot of times we're going to see right here as an example, I'm going to use the Broder File as an example of what all of these authors are doing. And this is a major reason why I left, right? What you'll notice is that they will make assertions and they'll cite to another person who's either in the same field as themselves, or just somebody who's making the same assertions, but not necessarily to an ancient text itself. And I'm gonna show you what I mean by that. But let's just take the etymology of the word Helios, for example. This is how he kind of starts off. This is like the springboard into the conversation about astrology and hidden meanings and this and that, right? And so the word holy in Greek is not Helios. As he said, it's sun, and it slips right past your frontal lobe there. It slips right past your awareness. He just told you that the word Helios means sun. He also said that it means holy, but it does not. There's a completely different word for holy, and that word is Hagios. So that being a foundational principle, and in these circles, in this subculture, the same 10 or so points are often repeated. And I'm gonna address some of them, and I make videos about them all the time. So you wanna subscribe to my channel and check out some of those videos as well. But it's the same 10 points, basically, that are repeated over and over, and nobody really stops for a second to really scrutinize what's being said. They just kind of take it for granted because it's being said by somebody in what they deem is a person of authority, like Broder. He wrote a book. And because he wrote a book, that, and he's been to Egypt, that means he knows what he's talking about. And it does not mean that. Let me give you another example from this same page. He talks about the Council of Nicaea in 332. And how Constantine made a law making, at the Council of Nicaea, making Christianity the official religion of the state and banning all other religions. It's not true. That didn't happen. That did not. First of all, the Council of Nicaea wasn't even in 332. It was in 325. So that very, for somebody who's a historian, who's presenting what he posits as historical fact, the entire book is based on this premise that he is a historian who studies and knows what he's talking about, and he's getting things like Helios wrong, and he's getting things like 325 and calling it 332, getting that wrong. And then additionally, the Council of Nicaea did not produce a law or an edict that said that Christianity was the official state religion. That actually never happened. Not only did it not happen in 332 or 325, it never happened. Constantine did not make a law saying Christianity was the official religion. What he did was he adopted Christianity as his personal religion, and he also made, by his actions, he made it aware that Christianity would have influence, and it began to become the most popular religion because of him being the emperor and people following his example, and then stuff like him branding the military shields with crosses and things of that nature. But if you look into the laws and try to find some sort of legal foundation for him making Christianity the official religion of Rome. You're not going to find that. And a lot of things that people claim about Constantine, you just don't find historically. And I just did a video. As a matter of fact, the video before this is entitled The Truth About Constantine, What He Did and Did Not Do. So you want to check that out. So he made Christianity the most popular religion by virtue of his influence and his actions. But in 313, which is far before 332, there's a document, a law that is passed, which is called the Edict of Milan. And what that document does, what that law states, is that Christianity is to no longer be persecuted. Christianity is now to be accepted along with a number of other religions. Like, it used to be that Christianity was not allowed in Rome. And then with the Edict of Milan, he changes the tide and says, listen, let these people practice their faith. Clearly, he's either on the road to becoming one or claiming to be one. But regardless, it was not exclusive to Christianity either. Like, he opened it and said, let people practice what they want to practice, right? So this assertion that Constantine made Christianity the official religion and banned all others is another lie. So then we have this quote here, which asserts that the documents, the original Bible, had lots of references to astrology, and it was changed at the Council of Nicaea, and so the literary style also changed, as you see him saying here, and they developed a new style of writing or a different style of writing that would somehow hide the astrology that's in the Bible or was originally in the Bible. And notice also that there are no references, like there's no citations throughout the pages. What he has is like a reference section at the end, but you can't fly with that. Like, you're not going to get a degree in history or any subject and write a paper and just have a list of references without specifically citing to where you got this particular piece of information from. And so he just makes this claim. He just says that the Bible was changed, and then he keeps it moving. And there's nothing there to validate what he's saying. But because of the power of influence, again, people just buy it like I did. So if you think critically about this, think critically. If he's saying that the Bible became Europeanized at this council, which is not true, they did not work on the Bible at this council. The collection of books that make up the Bible officially are referred to as canon. And they did not discuss biblical canon at the Council of Nicaea. We have documents that talk about, official documents, that talk about what happened at the Council of Nicaea. And what he is asserting here is not one of the things that happened there. So, so if you think critically about it, the assertion that he's making is that there should be a change. We should be able to see a difference between any manuscripts or documents purporting to be the Bible that originated before 332 or 325, as opposed to the ones that took place after, to the ones that we have afterwards. So, you know, a critical mind would look for ancient Bibles that would predate the council and compare them to the ones that we have today and see if the literary style changed or if there was references to the moon and sun and gods that are no longer there. And what you find if you do this, right, is that the oldest remaining fragments of the manuscripts that we have of scripture date back to 125, roughly. That's 200 years before the Council of Nicaea. It's called the St. John's Fragment, or the Ryland's Library Papyrus. And it contains the text of John chapter 18, verses 31 through 36, which the fragments read, "The Jews, for it is not permitted to kill anyone, so that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, which he spoke, signifying what kind of death he was going to die, entered therefore again into the praetorium Pilate, and summoned Jesus and said unto him, Thou art King of the Jews." So this is written in Greek, and this is the English rendering. And then, so I just pause there for a second. Like, I just find it extremely interesting. Not only is there a fragment that predates the council for 200 years, but it completely matches exactly what we have today. And it's a direct reference to Jesus and his trial. It's not some obscure, you know, it's clear that it's talking about a historical event, the actual person of Jesus, and not some astrological nonsense, as Broder asserts. And so the other portion are verses 37 and 38, which read, "A king I am, for this I have been born, and for this I have come into the world, so that I would testify to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears of me my voice." Said to him Pilate, "What is the truth?" And this having said again, he went out unto the Jews and said to them, "I find not one fault in him." So that completely matches exactly what we have today. So where is the evidence that the Europeans at this council changed the Bible? The evidence does not exist. It's simply an often repeated lie with much passion behind it and absolutely no fact, no record, no documents to prove what he's saying. So this is something I personally find to be very monumental. Like, if you're going to take away somebody's faith and you're going to base it on some supposed historical inaccuracy or some claim that you're making, you should be able to back it up. But he doesn't even attempt to back it up. He hits you with the regular old same thing everybody else always says, do your research. because there is no documentation to validate what he's saying. So then on page 72 of this same book, he says that the virgin birth originated in Kemet. The story of the virgin birth originated in Kemet, and that Isis, Osiris, and Horus were the original Trinity. Now, first of all, he doesn't even bother to give the account of what happened with Osiris and Isis. He just says that the original virgin birth took place in ancient Africa or Egypt, and that's where the story came from. But if you study these two stories, even if you just read them, you'll see that there's no comparison. Like, there's nothing that they have in common. So the story of Isis and Osiris, basically Osiris, which is a Greek term for which are Greek terms for these Egyptian deities, whose names are Asar, Aset, and Heru. But the popular names are what everybody knows them by: Isis, Osiris, and Horus. So that's what I'll use. So Osiris and his brother Set, which, by the way, Isis is also both of their sister. We'll get to that in a moment. The brothers were having an argument. They were having a war, basically, over the throne of Osiris because he was king. And so Set basically kills him and eventually basically scatters his body parts all over the then known kingdom, right? And his wife, Isis, then goes, yes, I said his wife, who I also said was his sister, because that's just what it is. She goes and finds the different pieces and puts them together, and just one piece is missing, and that is the reproductive part. And so she constructs a phallus and impregnates herself by the body of her dead husband. So, two things. They walked together supposedly before he died. They were already married before he died. So there's no reason to infer that she was by any means a virgin, right? But then even if she had been when he died, she sure wasn't after he died. If that's the way she conceived their son, Horus, was by necromancy, like in its worst form, right? So these two stories have nothing to do with each other, but the assertion is made. That's where that all of the books, all of these so-called scholars make the same argument, that this is where these the virgin birth originates, which clearly this isn't even a virgin birth. And this theme of claiming something to be the originating foundation, we'll see over and over that just never holds up. So he then goes into this rant about astrology and allegory and a bunch of nonsense that even doesn't even bear repeating, because Jesus actually walked this earth. Like, it's very interesting, like, for people to make this claim that it's all allegory when there was a human being that we know historically walked this earth. The argument amongst scholars is not whether he existed or not. The argument amongst scholars is whether or not he was who he said he was and is who he says he is. You know what I'm saying? So biblical archaeology also it confirms so much of the historical aspect of what scripture records as having taken place. And I have other videos on that. You can go on my website and check out / biblical archaeology and see some of these pieces, these artifacts, these locations even that are referred to in scripture and how they so well line up with the history that the Bible is presenting. So to say that it's all symbolism and it all means something having to do with the stars and astrology is utter nonsense. That's like saying that you yourself are just a representation of the sun. You don't exist for real. Like, what? 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 Anyway, where he gets this idea from is very interesting. So we're going to look at his sources. Again, he just lists a bunch of sources. He doesn't say which part of what assertion he made came from which source. He just throws a bunch of books up there and says, hey, read these if you want to learn more, right? And amongst these authors that are listed here, we see Percy Graves, who is, and the book, The 16 Crucified Saviors, which Broder mentions in this essay. He says that there were many crucified saviors, 16 in number, at least, prior to Jesus supposedly walking the earth, which is a lie. Graves himself, aside from being a European, was an atheist. He was an atheist who went out of his way to try to disprove Christianity by making up, he literally made up claims about all of these other ancient religions that supposedly predate Christianity and supposedly predate Christianity or Judaism, and say that they were stolen, specifically Christianity, that they were stolen by Europeans and repackaged into Christianity. So the irony is that these Afrocentric authors are all relying on an atheist European who does not hold the same positions that they hold with regards to anything. But what you'll find is that when something is of service to and serves their purpose, they will quote Europeans, but only when it serves their purposes, right? So we'll take Prometheus, for example, a Greek deity who they say was one of the 16 crucified saviors who also resurrected, right? So he was actually tied to a mountain by Zeus. And while strapped to this mountain for 30,000 years, not 30 years like Graves claims, but 30,000 years, an eagle would come and eat his liver every day. And then every night it would grow back just for him to have it eaten out by this eagle again the next day. And this was a form of like punishment for him. But the interesting thing about Prometheus is that he was immortal. He could not die. So there's no way for him to die and be resurrected. It was him living on for 30,000 years and having this happen to him day after day after day, that was his torture, because he could not escape by way of death. Like, there are ancient texts that tell this myth, and Prometheus is saying that he wished he could die, but he can't, so he's just gonna be subjected to this torture. Now, Percy Graves grabs a hold of this story and completely changes it. He completely fabricates or takes certain pieces and just runs with it. One of those things is that he says that, of course, he says he was crucified to a wooden stake instead of having been tied to a rock or a mountain, which is what the original document says. And then he takes the 30,000 years and shrivels them down to 30 years, because we know that Jesus walked the earth for 33 years, and makes this false correlation and says, you see, Christianity came from this, but everything he's asserting as similarities are things that he himself has either fabricated or distorted. And this is a theme throughout the entire book and throughout whatever people come afterwards and say, because Percy Graves is like a pivotal figure. He's like a touchstone figure within this Christ mythology. What basically, that's the assertion that Christianity is a myth. And people just repeat it, repeat it, repeat it, repeat it. That's the work of the devil. Like, that is spiritual sophistry at its finest. Like, nobody fact checks Percy Graves. Everybody just sees something that is extremely convenient to disprove Christianity, and they keep repeating it. And a lie often repeated somehow in their minds becomes the truth, right? So if we look at the other scholars, we'll see that they all refer back to Percy Graves. So if I write a book, right? Let's just say I wrote a book about the Constitution of the United States. And I'm giving you supposed quotes from the Constitution, but I'm skewing them, or I'm making them up, I'm adding to them, I'm taking them away, I'm shaping them in a way that I want you to perceive what the Constitution says. And then somebody comes behind me, Kevin we'll call him, and he he quotes me for what the Constitution says. And then, so Kevin's over here, and then Alice is over here, and she's quoting me as well. But then there are people who are quoting them. And this is basically the scholarship of the conscious community. It's a bunch of people quoting off of other people who are also within this circle, and they're all leading back to this one person. But now, wait, why did they not just read the Constitution for themselves and write a book? Why are they relying on Kersey Graves' explanation when the texts are available for analysis yourself? And once you start doing that, once you start going to the primary text, so for those of you who don't know, that's what's referred to as a primary text, the actual document or a document from that time relating to something that was originally produced during the time period in question. And then a secondary source would be something that refers to or talks about the primary source. So within this community, there are no primary sources. Nobody actually approaches the primary sources for the most part, unless they are hieroglyphs. But even that, the hieroglyphs were decoded by Europeans. I think the irony of that is just, it's mind-blowing. But anyway, so we'll see in this bibliography that he has people like John Jackson, who quotes Kersey Graves for his arguments about many saviors coming before Christ. He quotes him a couple of times in this book you see right here. And then also listed is Yosef Ben Yochanan, who, this guy, he's so shady. Like, he's so shady. His overall history, personal history, is completely obscured. Nobody knows anything about this guy. The things that he says about himself, when they're fact-checked, you can't find them. So he says that he was born in Ethiopia. Sources indicate that's not true. He lists a bunch of different schools that he supposedly got degrees from, and people have called the registrar to these different institutions, and there are no records of his ever having attended there, much less graduated with a degree. So this is another staple, another master teacher within this subculture that doesn't really have exposure to the primary information for himself, or doesn't care to. He finds it sufficient to rely on the word of somebody else, right? He quotes Graves as well. And so again, you see this circle of them just borrowing from each other, but they're all borrowing from Graves. Now, that's one aspect of it. I said all that to say, this is why I left, because if you're taking away Christianity and you're saying all these things about Jesus, I should be able to validate that. I should be able to go back and read the story of Prometheus for myself and be able to see, wow, he was 30 years old and he was crucified to a stake and he died and resurrected. But none of those things are true. They're not. But the issue is, most people aren't going to do that. Like, most people don't have the time or the energy or even the desire to go back and study for themselves. So that's one reason why I left. And another issue that I found spiritually and just emotionally was that psychologically it's draining. Like, being part of that culture is draining, because everything you're exposed to is, you're lied to, you're hated, they want to be you. That's it. Like, that's it. They want to be you, they hate you, and they lying to you. But the irony is that the people that are promoting this, you've been lied to, are also lying. They're lying about or exaggerating, like gross exaggerations, right? They take little things and they make Kemet, not just Africa, but Kemet specifically, the originator of all things. Kemet invented religion. Kemet invented women and children. And there are some valid historical inventions and things of that nature that can be tied to Kemet. So I'm not taking that away, but it's an overcompensation and an exaggeration to say that everything originated, it's all black. It's all, not only is it black, it came from Egypt. Everything came from Egypt. Like, you're shooting yourself in the foot by doing that, because the credibility of that is what's happening is, people are coming forward and saying history has been whitewashed, and they're making it better by blackwashing everything. And a truly balanced person, a person who's truly seeking after the truth, right? Because that's what we're in this for. We're in it for the truth. If you're actually seeking the truth, that's not going to be something that's going to satisfy you, because it's not true. It's an exaggeration, which by definition is a lie. It's a distortion. So, you know, it just, all the main benefits, and it's not even a benefit, it's a detriment, but the main benefit of being part of that community is that it just fuels your pride. It fuels the, it provides like a healing for, again, the oppression and the messaging that we've been getting through the media, and it tells you that you're better than what society says that you were, but it does so by lying. And so psychologically, the lies are one thing, but then just that state of disgruntlement all the time, like everything just, it's so dark. It's not dark in terms of being evil, it's dark in terms of like depression or sadness and anger. Like, around every corner there's another lie that's been in there, and there's another weapon against Black people, and like everything is like pointed against, and I think the messaging in that is horrible. Like, you're actually perpetuating what you call the attack on the people by repeating it and focusing on it for so much. It, like, it doesn't breed joy, it doesn't breed happiness or freedom, it just takes you from one form of bondage to another. And I can't vibe with that. Like, I mean obviously I did it for years, but coming out of it you realize like it's very cultish. It's very cultish in the sense that they focus on these few centralized characters who are the authors and teachers of Afrocentricity. But then on top of that, it's like the things that you think about all the time, things that you're focused on mentally, your goals, the people you hang out with, the conversations that you have, are focused on a very narrow view of the world. And that's, it just, it's heartbreaking. It's heartbreaking because there's so much more to life, right? There's so much more to life than just focusing on being oppressed. And another bone, if I'm being honest, another bone that I have with it is like, the main aim is to spread the message, like wake somebody else up, which is cool, but then what? Like, you just wake them up for them to go wake somebody else up. There's no spiritual advancement. There's no sense of trying to better oneself spiritually or better one's character morally or ethically. There's none of that. It's just do you. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's a free-for-all when it comes to spirituality. A lot of them do not practice. Most of them do not practice these indigenous religions to Kemet. They don't practice that. They don't even believe in God. They don't believe in spirits, a lot of them. Some of them do, and they turn to African traditional religions. But the underlying premise is not one of liberation. They just call it liberation from... And if it's going to liberate you from anything, it's going to be from believing lies about yourself that you're not worthy. And I'm not saying that's not important. That is important. But there have been, this subculture has existed for decades now, and we don't see a real movement as a result of it. We don't see real progress as a result of people who identify as part of this subculture. We just see them perpetuating the same ten lies. Council of Nicaea, ISIS horror set, Jesus was stolen from this, virgin that. Like, that's all we see over and over and over again, and that doesn't really serve anybody. It doesn't. There's no mobilization. There's no repatriation even back to. There's none of that. It's just really interesting conversation and boosters for your pride is what I found. So. I feel like it breeds racism. It breeds this hatred, in which I was blessed not to have internalized, because I had a teacher in high school who was a white man, and he was like my best friend. Like, he was amazing, right? So I could never buy into this myth that all white people are evil and all. I couldn't, because I'd experienced something to the contrary. So I had tangible evidence that just wasn't true. But for the most part, what I see is that people in this subculture kind of turn into the very thing they say they hate. You mad because they stole your history and now you're stealing everybody's history. There's no Arab origins of anything. There's no Asian origins of everything. Is African in origin. Like, that's just not fair, and it's not honest, and it's not productive to the goals we should be having. It's not honest. So in conclusion, the reason why I left was because it was a lie, and I'm somebody who's very much interested in the truth, and it's almost like a maturity thing. Not a maturity, it's a growth. It's an issue of growth. The difference between knowing how to read and learning how to study and applying what it means to conduct research and study and fact check what people have to offer you. That's the difference between, I think, people who are in this subculture and those who either left it or don't join it. Because once you start doing that, you see that everything that's being offered to you is a lie. Like, all they're saying to you is basically the same thing that the serpent said to Eve: you will be as gods and you'll never die. And it's like, your legacy will never die, because we're going to return back to the whatever it is our ancestors had. So I see all these things happening, and I'm studying the Bible, and I'm studying the historicity of Jesus, and I'm starting to see that, yeah, these people are lying. Christianity has a real foundation in historical reality, and Jesus himself is a historical person who actually existed. And why would they lie about that? Like, why would that be something of interest, right? If anything, leave the discussion off the table, right? Leave the discussion off the table and focus on Afrocentricity. But you can't. They cannot have the conversation about returning to your roots without addressing Christianity. And so the two go hand in hand, and it almost seems like it's constructed to be an attack on Christianity. If you have any questions about this, this is just a part of my testimony. I know it was long. I was trying to make it as thorough as possible to give you a full explanation as to why I left Kemet, why I left Egypt, and the spiritual implications of it, and the symbolism, what the Bible talks about as it relates to Egypt. I think it's extremely interesting, because the fact that we're still being drawn, especially African Americans, are still being drawn toward Egypt spiritually by this, what I think is a designed, orchestrated attack against Christianity, is really telling of the spiritual nature behind it. And so this is why I still use the terminology woke. Like, my tagline is Christian, Black, Woke. Like I said in the beginning, I talk about things related to that. Answer questions related to being Christian, being Black, and being woke. Because to be woke, once again, is to be aware of the tools of oppression that are used to subjugate people. But I think what's missing is why. Right? They think it's because you're melanin. It's the melanin. Like, it's because you're Black. No. It's spiritual. This is a spiritual issue. And without recognizing that there are intelligent beings who we don't see with our eyes, right? Who are behind the scenes pushing buttons and pulling strings, you don't understand oppression. You don't understand the core of the issue. You're focused on the wrong thing. And so you're always gonna get the wrong result. And I don't think that you can be woke if you're lacking that. So if you guys have any questions, feel free to reach out to me, neff@neffernanny.com. Thank you for watching this video. This is just a piece of my testimony. I'm gonna do another video about why I left other phases of my spiritual journey, right? And I wanna actually go into more detail addressing some of the claims that Kersey Graves made, that Broder made, and show you, like I kind of did here, how I know they're lying, right? And hopefully you'll be able to either use this for yourself or pass it along to somebody so that they can start to investigate for themselves. And it's really important to see the primary text and know whether these things that are being asserted are true or not, because spiritually, it really is a life and death situation, and the enemy is gunning for your death. Stay Christian, stay Black, stay woke.